Stomp-A-Trons of Invincible Wrath was the start of the second block of sets in the Duel Masters trading card game. This meant that instead of containing 60 cards, this set had 120 cards, many of which proved to be the strongest cards printed to date. It also released at a crucial time as the 2005 Invitation Circuit tournaments had just been announced. This circuit of tournaments hosted around North America had two age divisions, one for age 14 and under, and one for age 15 and up. The top two finishers in each age division would qualify for the 2005 Continental Championships in Los Angeles, California. As players prepared to vie for these limited spots, they started to get more creative, looking for powerful new decks to catch others off guard and win the tournaments with. While Water Darkness control decks continued to hold the top spots, things changed on May 7th, 2005, after the German National Championships. A 13-year-old boy named Nguyen Phuc An took first place, piloting a Dark Water Fire control deck. The addition of fire allowed him to use more explosive finishers in Twin Cannon Sky Terror and Bazigazeel Dragon, while also enabling mass removal with Searing Wave and Burst Shot. While it was less polished than later Dark Water Fire control decks, this proved to be a turning point in the meta, in which the archetype quickly gained dominance. In this series, both Michael and myself will be taking you on a journey through time. Each episode, we will look at a time in Duel Masters past, showcasing the evolution of the metagame as new sets are released. Using real decks from that time, we will play a best 2 out of 3 match to relive the game as it once was. This is the history of Duel Masters. And we are back with Stomp-A-Trons of Invincible Wrath, one of the fan favorite sets. This is like the introduction of the second block of cards, meaning that there's 120 cards in this set rather than the typical 60. Now, because there's 120 cards, that means there are a lot of good cards that just make some more decks way more powerful than they used to be. And it really kind of starts changing the whole metagame, especially around the control decks. Control decks before tended to be more limited to like Water Darkness, and then sometimes with Light like we saw with the Hydro Hurricane decks. But now we have control decks of so many different varieties coming in. On top of that, we're keeping up with a lot of like the evolutions, especially Water Nature is still just as popular as ever. Survivors actually get a lot of new creatures that are insanely powerful and actually make it into a tournament winning deck. On this wheel, we have more decks I think than we ever have, and a lot of them are really good. Like, there's not really anything on this wheel that I'm like, please don't spin, please don't spin, please don't spin like we used to be. We removed the rush this week so you guys don't have to put up with me just drawing the worst cards ever and just like hitting shield triggers and losing on turn 3. We are gonna have a legit game this time and I am very excited about that. Let's just go through really quick and say what the decks are.
For the competitive metagame as a whole, probably the biggest story of this set is Dark Water Fire Control. So in this most recent set, we got some new powerful fire cards printed, in particular Bulmedius Steel Dragon and Bazigazeel Dragon. And so due to a combination of those and people just realizing that some of the older fire cards were also pretty good in a control shell, this archetype just started exploding in popularity around this time. I don't know if it's quite the most played deck yet, but it will be very soon if it's not yet as of Stomp-A-Trons of Invincible Wrath. But even aside from Darkwater Fire Control, this set still does a lot of other things to shake things up. You've got a ton of new Survivor support, which actually brings Survivors into being a viable deck type now. You've got a Pyrofighter Magnus breathing new life into Rush decks. You've got the release of Crazed Valkyrie the Drastic, which by itself enables some like aggressive light-based strategies in order to work. There's just a lot to work with here, and you can see that because we've got a lot of things on the wheel for this week. I will just go through these quickly, even though I've talked about some of them already. Dark Water Fire Control, it's sort of like the Dark Water Control builds we've seen before, but obviously it adds fire. And in particular, this gives it access to cards like Searing Wave, which helps the deck deal with wide boards very efficiently, as well as some really strong finishers such as Twin Cannon Sky Terror, Bulmedius Steel Dragon, and Bazigazeel Dragon. all in all, just a really, really good control deck. Honestly, I may be spinning for that this week. Water Nature Liquid Beasts is still around. It gets a few new toys to play with, but it's mostly the same deck. Four Civ Control starts being popular around this time. The way we've got this on the wheel here, it's just a catch-all, really, for any control deck running four or more colors. Most of them, it turns out, are sort of like Dark Water Fire Control builds, but also splashing a few light or nature cards that are good that they want to be using also. Survivors, it's the same general idea as the last episode, but because of two new cards printed in this set, Factory Shell Q, which lets it get a lot of value in the late game, and Qtronic Gargantua, the Survivor Evolution, that is a really good finisher in the archetype. It just gets a lot more strength, and it actually becomes a pretty reasonable deck right now. Kray's Valkyrie, this is, again, sort of a catch-all for aggressive strategies running Kray's Valkyrie the Drastic, another new card in this set. It's an Initiate Evolution and a Double Breaker, which lets you tap two of your opponent's creatures. And so that can just tap down two blockers and allow you to swing for game. And this lets you make some, like, really strong finishing plays in aggressive decks, basically. Just a pretty good archetype all around. Mono Nature, same as before. Water Dark Control, again, mostly the same as before. And Mono Light and Mono Dark are still around. They've gotten new toys to play with, but the deck hasn't really changed a whole lot, I don't think.
What do we want to spin? Dark Water Fire Control is probably the best. Water Dark Control is really good too. Survivors is hella fun. I would love to play that. Kray's Valkyrie is one of my favorite cards. Water Nature Liquid Beast, I haven't gotten to play yet. There's so many good stuff. I don't even care. Let's see what I get. I probably won't even respin no matter what it is. Kray's Valkyrie. Oh, wait, we get Survivors. Oh my god. That is so fun. Now, is it the best thing on here? Probably not, but it's such a cool deck. I don't think I can justify spinning again. Not when I get Survivors. I'm going to take it. I'm going to play Survivors. Let's go.
I don't really know exactly what I want to play. Honestly, I'm probably fine with most of these, to be quite honest. I guess let's just get the first spin and see what we get, and then I'll decide. Okay, we've got Kray's Valkyrie. So I do kind of want to play this, but I also think this is what Ben is spinning for, and I don't know if I want to go with a mirror match or not. There is one of those four Civ control decks I really thought looked like a fun deck to play, but yep, alright, we'll do this. We'll play Kray's Valkyrie. I'm not sure if this is the best thing I can do or not, but let's try it out. We'll go with this.
What an awesome deck this is. Survivors is just such a cool concept. If you don't know what it is, I'll explain it really quickly and then go through the card by card. So, Survivor is like this race of creature that exists throughout all five civilizations. And all of the Survivor creatures, which you can see by having that little, like, weird, like, it looks like a biohazard icon on the side. It says Survivor. Each of your Survivors has this creature's Survivor ability. So, for example, Blazosaur is a power attacker plus 1,000. So, because of this Survivor effect, all of your other Survivors also become power attacker plus 1,000, as well as Blazosaur picking up the effects from all those Survivors. So, the bigger your field gets, the stronger your Survivors become. They just become this massive, like, field that just have insane effects by the time you get all of them out. If you can get, like, at, like, 4 to 5 of them on the field, their effects are just so powerful that you pretty much just win the game using them. The whole strategy behind this deck is just use these, like, Survivors to get to Factory Shell Q. Factory Shell Q is the key. With this creature, all of your Survivors get the ability that when you put it into the battle zone, you can search your deck for another Survivor, add it to your hand, and shuffle your deck. So now you search out a Survivor, you play the Survivor, and guess what? Because he shares the effect across all of them, you get to search again for another Survivor, while also giving all your other creatures the effect of that Survivor you just played. So you can see how this just snowballs. If you can get a decent amount of them on board, you pretty much are winning the game. Such a fun and cool deck. The deck that you see in front of you is the deck that won an Invitational Circuit tournament in Texas to qualify for the 2005 North American Continental Championships. Now, there is one caveat to that, and that's that the actual decklist itself has been lost through the history of time, and all that we have left is another player's, like, from-memory recreation of the deck. The player that recreated the deck is the player that got second, so he did see it firsthand, and is somebody that plays against that player very often, so we can assume this is fairly accurate to what it actually looked like. However, I cannot guarantee that these are the exact card counts that were used, but overall the deck looked very, very similar to this. I do not know the name of the player that won. If I figure it out by the time I post this video, I will just like put it up there or something, but it did win the Invitation Circuit Tournament to qualify for the Continental Championships. Let's jump into the card by card, and I will tell you all about this crazy deck. So first of all, we have Blazosaur Q. Now, this card is in here not really because its survivor effect is powerful. Power Attacker plus 1000 is like okay, it's not the best, but it's more of because it's a 2-cost survivor. So once you get a bunch of other survivors on board and he inherits their effects, he becomes a really powerful creature for just 2 mana. Same thing with Smashhorn Q, it's 3 mana, but his ability is a little bit stronger in that he gives all your other survivors plus 1000 power. At the same time, he's going to inherit the other effects and just be a pretty darn good 3 mana creature. Skull Sweeper Q is pretty awesome as well. This creature gives all of your survivors essentially a Horrid Worm effect. So just imagine following up like a turn 3 Smashhorn Q with a Skull Sweeper. Well, now you've got a 3000 Horrid Worm that's just going in, and maybe even your Blazosaur if you had one too. So it just makes it so you can start poking early without losing advantage. And it's also just super good where later on, once they have tapped creatures and stuff, you can just like get this out, kill a tapped creature with another survivor, and then they also have to discard a card, and you can just snowball an advantage really well. So we're gonna be running 3 copies of that. 3 copies of Graveworm Q. This one lets you, whenever you summon a survivor, you get to return a survivor from your graveyard back to your hand. So even if your opponent starts killing your stuff, you just get to keep taking it back and just reusing it, and just making for even more powerful effects as the game goes on. 3 Factory Shell Q, this is like one of the biggest powerhouses in the deck. It lets you search your deck for any survivor. So usually the way you're gonna do this is like, do you need the Ripple Lotus? You can bring that out. Do you need to get through blockers? You can bring out Spike Strike Ichthys. Like, it kind of lets you search out the effect that you need. Or it lets you just like, if you have this on field, next turn you could theoretically just like drop Blazosaur, use the survivor ability because now he lets you search something, search out another Blazosaur, drop that, use its effect, search another Blazosaur, and then just build up a massive field of survivors super quickly. So it is an insanely powerful card to have. Next we have the water section. Now there's not very many water cards in here, and that's why we're playing 4 ofs on these water survivors, but they do have quite useful effects. Ripple Lotus Q is, it lets you tap an opponent's creature when you play it. Why this is a water card and not a light card, I honestly could not tell you, but this is going to be really good, because if we start tapping down opponent's creatures while we have a Skull Sweeper on board, then we're going to start killing stuff while discarding from their hand, and now we just lock down the opponent completely, because even if they summon on their turn, now any survivor that we summon is going to tap down stuff as well. So it's so good to have this card on board. Spike Strike Ichthys is not quite as good, it makes all your survivors unblockable, but it's not horrible. Diamond Cutter decks are a thing to be aware of, so you gotta be ready for it, and this is a way to just slide right underneath all of them. Finally, we have the boss creature, Cutronic Gargantua. It's kind of a mouthful to say, Cutronic Gargantua. Anyways, this is an evolution to survivors, so it can go on top of any of the survivors in the deck. This is the first card in English Duel Masters that has the Crew Breaker text. This means that for all of your survivors, it breaks another shield. So if you have a field of 5 survivors, he's just a world breaker, break all your opponent's shields. On top of that, he is a survivor himself, so he is still inheriting the effects of all your other survivors, even though he doesn't share an ability with anybody else. We also have 3 copies of Bronze Arm Tribe in the creatures just to help accelerate, because this deck wins once you get enough mana to actually start getting out a massive field and doing a lot of things quickly. If you can't survive until then, you're gonna lose, so he just helps you ramp up to get there a little bit earlier. Same thing with our 3 Fairy Lives. It's also a shield trigger, so if there's an aggressive deck, I'll be getting mana for free a little bit quicker. The rest of the spell lineup is pretty much just entirely based on surviving and surviving a survivor deck. No, it's about just like surviving by removing opponent's creatures and just making sure they don't have a chance to set up their board. So we've got 2 Tornado Flames, which is just decent target removal, 2 Searing Waves to just completely board wipe the opponent, And two, Burst Shot. Burst Shot's great because it's a shield trigger, but we do have a lot of things that will die to it, like the Skull Sweepers, the Bronze Arms, the Blazosaurs, and Ripple Lotus and Factory Shell. However, if we have the Smash Horns out, it is going to power up all our survivors and make us a little bit safer to make Burst Shot a little bit better. And finally, of course, we have the four copies of Terror Pit. Now, this was not the most popular deck, but there were survivor decks winning tournaments, and it's just such an awesome deck that I'm excited to just show you guys what it's like. I hope it's going to win. I don't want to go down three episodes in a row, so let's see what we can do. I'm excited to play it. It's time to duel.
All right, so here's the deck list we're taking to today's episode. This is a water light tempo deck, but whereas some of the tempo decks earlier on in the history of Duel Masters that I've played, they were like really heavy on bounce spells, this deck here, it still has some bounce, but it leans more into Crazed Valkyrie the Drastic, which is obviously the card that we put in this entry slot on the wheel. But this is another card you can use in a tempo sort of deck, and it's just a really, really good card. It's a 6 mana Initiate Evolution with 7500 power and Double Breaker, and it lets you tap down two of your opponent's creatures in the battle zone when it enters. And so if you're against like slower decks, this can tap down their only blockers and allow you to swing with all of your early attackers for game. Or if you're against another aggressive deck, you can use this to just tap down two of their creatures and then kill them before they're able to evolve onto their liquid people or beast folk with whatever their evolution creature of choice is. So this can be used both for like board control and for clearing the way to swing for game. And so this is just a really good all around card. And then obviously the rest of the deck is just sort of good value cards, good tempo cards, or initiates to support Crazed Valkyrie the Drastic, essentially. Anyways, I will go through the card by card. First, we have 4 Spiral Gate, just 2 mana bounce a creature. We've seen this before in the history of Duel Masters, just a really, really good card, especially for tempo decks like this. 4 Emerald, we've seen this before also. 4 Sarius Vizier of Suppression. This is an early blocker, which is going to be useful against rush decks. It's also an initiate, so we can use this to evolve into our Crazed Valkyrie the Drastic. Next, 2 Aqua Hulkus. Just a really good card, sort of similar to the deck last week though. We actually like Magras more in this deck because it's an initiate, but it's hard to say no to 3 mana, 2000 power, and draw a card when it enters, so we are still running 2 of this card. Next we have 4 Miel Vizier of Lightning. So the main reason we're running this is because it's an initiate, but it's also got a pretty good effect. It's a 3 mana 1000 power creature. When you play it, you can tap your opponent's creature, and so similar to Crazed Valkyrie, this can like tap down their blocker and allow us to swing for game when we couldn't otherwise, or we can use it as like board control basically. Next, 2 Cenotine Jade Tree. This doesn't really synergize with the rest of the deck, but we do still need a few more blockers than just the 4 Sarius, and there's unfortunately no initiate blocker in this 3 drop slot, so we're just running these Cenotine Jade Trees. Actually, the fact that Pyrofighter Magnus is out now means that the fact that this has 4000 power is actually pretty important. We can play this and it won't die to Pyrofighter. Next we have 2 Energy Stream, a new card from Stomp-A-Trons that's really good both for tempo and control decks. Just 3 mana, draw 2 cards. With a deck like this, we want to ensure that the resources keep flowing, and this is one of the ways we can do that. Next, 4 Magras, draws a card when it enters, and it's an initiate for Crazed Valkyrie. Pretty much an auto include in this deck. 4 Corile, it bounces a creature to the top of their deck. As always, this is really good. So this deck list here doesn't have a lot of ways to deal with some of the bigger evolution creatures. Hopefully we want to kill like their liquid people and beast folk before they're able to evolve. But if things don't work out and they're able to stick a Crystal Lancer or a Fighter Duel Fang, we don't actually have a lot of ways to deal with that. So I think in a list like this, where Core Isle can bounce the evolution creatures, and then you're like stacking two cards on top of their deck, I think this is actually going to be even more important in this particular deck list than it otherwise would be. Next, three Illusionary Merfolk, obviously just an insane card. Draw three cards, again, just keeps the resources flowing. Three, Crazed Valkyrie the Drastic. This is the key card of the deck. I already talked about this at the beginning. And then finally, four, Holy Awe. And then, okay, so one thing that I forgot to say at the beginning of this recording, by the way, so I did take this deck list from Aaron Pirat, who used this deck list to get to second place at an invitational circuit event in Texas. So the deck has performed quite well and is obviously quite strong. Anyways, yeah, so that's the deck. Let's just hop into the games and see how it does. I'm really excited to run this new powerful card in today's episodes.
Welcome everybody to Stomp-A-Trons of Invincible Wrath. Definitely a fan favorite set. What do you think?
Well, for sure. There's just so much from this set that's like a good, cool, fun, you name it.
When I think of Duel Masters, like, well, I probably think of the base set first, but like, this is like where my brain next goes. It's like this era of decks where like, there was all these new cards that came out, and I just remember playing with the cards from Stomp-A-Trons and sitting alone in my room and just trying to build a bunch of decks with them. And most of the decks were terrible, but I spent so much time just sitting alone in my room building these decks.
I still remember just like getting Bulbedius. That was just such a fun card.
Oh, it was just such
like,
it was
the coolest
card
ever. The shields just go to the graveyard.
That was unheard of at this time. Yeah. And you don't have to worry about like the Holy Oz anymore, which is the craziest part.
Yes.
All right. Well, let's roll this dice and see who gets to decide who's gonna go first or second. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right. 3, 2, 1, roll. Oh, let's go. I get to decide first.
My die rolling powers have abandoned me or something.
Your die roll powers in the progression series were cracked, and now I'm cracking a little bit.
Yeah. Right, only so fair, I suppose.
You've got a 40 card deck. I'm rocking 42.
We do not have the exact mirror match, which I'm happy about.
Yeah. Now, the thing to keep in mind is like there was no shitty rush deck on this wheel, so like that kind of changes things, I think. Yeah, I'm gonna risk it. I'm gonna go second.
All right.
I'm going for a heavy risk.
All right. And we'll make the first move then. Good luck.
Yeah. Good luck. I don't know if this was the right decision or not, but we're going with it.
Now I have no idea how to play this. This is a bizarre hand, too. All right. Well, Ben, I just want you to know I could be playing anything right now.
Uh-oh,
I could be playing literally anything, but I'm going to send Miel Vizier.
Oh, okay. Okay. Mana. I dig it.
Literally anything. You have no idea what my deck is right now.
See, you want to know the even funnier thing?
What?
You have no idea what my deck is right now.
I'm clueless. I just... I don't hard even do. It's a tapper, okay?
Yeah.
Didn't even know Survivors had a tap card.
Oh, they got a tap card.
Alright. We'll send Holy Awe to Banna, and we will run out Sarius Vizier of Suppression.
That's another initiate.
You can go ahead.
I'll draw.
I mean, what? You think I'm playing initiate, Ben? No.
Hey, you could be playing Diamond Cutter still. You could technically still be playing Alcideus, for all I know. Alright, I'm not too concerned with this burst shot. I think I'm gonna run out the Blazosaur. Go ahead.
Humbly regretted, sending this Miel to Bad. I assumed you were on some control deck.
Yeah, I mean, this is kind of a control deck.
Yes. We'll send Spiral Gate to mana, okay. And we will play... Yeah, we'll play Energy Stream.
Okay, that's a pretty good one.
And go ahead.
I'm gonna charge the Fairy Life and end the turn.
Alright.
My poor Blazosaur isn't strong enough to do anything.
Yeah, I guess we send Illusionary Merfolk to mana. And we will play Another Miel Vizier of okay. Lightning. Tap down your Blazosaur. Sarius will kill it.
Yep.
And go ahead. Gotta get the survivors out of there quick.
They start stacking up. We're gonna put Terabit to mana.
Right. Four color survivors, okay.
I'm gonna run out the Skull Sweeper Q.
Alright.
My Horrid Worm survivor.
We'll send Magris to mana. We will play Aquahulkus.
Okay. I don't like how many cards you're drawing right now.
And next we'll play Emerald.
Okay.
Using the effect, set a card as Shield 6, and then pick this up. And I don't really... I guess we could go in. Nah, okay, we'll end there.
I will draw a card. We're gonna charge the Grave Worm Q, I think.
Alright.
And I'm gonna pay 5 mana for the first time we've seen this in the history of Duel Masters series.
Oh, that one hurts, okay.
Yeah. When I saw you play the Aquahulkus, I'm like, please play an Emerald. So, I will lose a Bronze Arm Shrine.
It actually does that, okay.
And now I could hit your new shield that you put down while discarding, which feels not that bad. But I kind of also like just having a survivor on board, so like, I have to think if that's worth it or not. I could also just hit a different shield. I think I probably will. No, because if you put down a Holy Awe, I want to get rid of it now. I'm going to hit the shield that you set down with Emerald.
Alright, hang on. There a random discard button?
Yes. No, this is when this creature attacks your opponent, chooses and discards.
Oh, I choose, okay.
Yes. So it's actually
that
not quite a Horrid Worm.
Which one do I want to discard, though? We don't have any initiates. I guess we get rid of the Crazed Valkyrie.
Oh, okay. I'm not too mad about that.
All right, and that shield's good.
Okay, then I'll end the turn. Yeah, it felt pretty good getting rid of multiple initiates when you're sitting at 5 mana on the one Searing Wave.
Interesting is somehow I still have more cards than you. Jeez.
Yeah, Energy Stream, Aquahulkus, all pretty good.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't need to play mana. Oh, we'll Corile that thing.
Okay.
For some reason, Corile is no longer working with targeted.
My go?
Yeah.
Okay. I will draw. I'm gonna play the Skull Sweeper to mana.
Alright.
And I'm gonna run out Factory Shell Q.
Okay.
Factory Shell Q is gonna let me search my deck. And I'm gonna take Smash Horn Q.
Alright.
And then I'll end my turn.
How do we win the game from this point? His Factory Shell gets out of hand quick.
Oh yeah, he does. He's so much fun when you get him going.
Yeah, I think we try and slow you down and hope we draw into either a Tapper or like a Merfolk or something. So we'll tap 3 for Cenotine Jade Tree. Actually, okay. No, I take this back. We're
okay,
not
yeah,
doing
go
that.
For it. Go for it. Nobody saw anything.
We're tapping 2 for Sarius. And we're tapping 2 for Spiral Gate to bounce the Factory Shell. And go ahead.
I'll draw a card. Oh, this is such a weird one now. No, you know what? I'm gonna play the Ripple Lotus to mana. I'm just gonna trust that you are not gonna top deck the Crazed Valkyrie, and I'm gonna Factory Shell Q. And I'm going to take... I think I'm just gonna take another Smash Horn Q. And then on your turn.
You've got 2 Smash Horns and 1 other card in your hand. This could be the Miel Vizier of Lightning. We'll just throw this card into our shields for the second time this game.
Oh no, that's what it was?
That's what it was, yeah. That is not a Miel Vizier of Lightning. But, yeah, I think we go in, actually.
Okay.
We've got to close the game somehow, and waiting around while you've got Factory Shell does not seem like the best way to do that. Go ahead.
I'm going to draw. I'm going to play Factory Shell number 2 to mana. I'm going to pay 3. You have 1 card in hand, yeah. Factory Shell, I'm going to search my deck. All cards. I am going to take Ripple Lotus Q.
Okay.
I am going to pay 4 mana for Skull Sweeper Q.
Okay.
I'm going to look at all cards, and I am going to take... How do I want to do this? I think I will take the Factory Shell.
Right, so you've got Factory Shell, another Smash Horn, and Ripple Lotus, and one other card.
Yep.
Okay.
Now, I do have the same power as your blocker, and I can attack and make you discard. And since I am holding the other Factory Shell, I think I do want to do that.
Yeah, I'll block. And the card I'm discarding is Chlorile.
Okay, yeah, that's not too bad then. And I'll end the turn. I figured this way I can at least get rid of the Crazed Valkyrie bait or the Crazed Valkyrie from the hand or something.
Right, right. This is just gonna get discarded anyways. Your Ripple Lotus can tap these down anyways. You don't really even need more value. I think you're just gonna kill these anyways. So yeah, we're going to go in with Emerald.
Okay, I will Shield Trigger Fairy Life.
Alright, and go in with Chlorile.
Okay.
And go ahead.
I will draw Fairy Life to mana. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 for the Factory Shell Q.
Okay.
He's gonna take Blazosaur. 3 mana for Smash Horn. He's gonna take Grave Worm Q, I guess.
Okay.
Yeah, Grave Worm, that's fine. And then with these two, I will just kill your creatures.
Yeah, alright.
Go ahead. I wish you luck. I don't know what you could top deck to get out of this, to be honest.
We'll Spiral Gate the Factory Shell.
Alright.
Go ahead.
I'll draw. Do I even need the Factory Shell at this point? Probably not. I don't really need the other Skull Sweeper. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, we'll just do the Factory Shell. We're gonna take Smash Horn Q. Then we're gonna pay 5 for Grave Worm. Take back Blazosaur with his effect. And then I'm gonna look at my deck. And I'm gonna take Spike Strike Ichthys Q.
Alright.
And then I will end the turn.
I don't know what we're gonna do with this, but we'll play Magras.
Yep.
And I guess I roll game. Guess we'll hit the thing that discards.
Alright.
Go ahead.
I'll draw. Spike Strike Ichthys to mana. Alright, 4, 5, 6 for Ripple Lotus. So we are going to tap the Magras.
Yeah.
Won't let me target it. Alright.
He's tapped.
With that, I will, from my graveyard, take back the Factory Shell. And then from my deck, I will take a Blazosaur.
Okay.
We're going to Skull Sweeper. Honestly, I'm not even going to bother taking stuff at this point. I don't care
sure.
at this. So because you did mess up and I know what your shield is, number 7, I'm going to go Factory Shell. I'm going to hit shield number 7.
All right.
And then I'm going to go Smash Horn.
Power move right there.
And I'm going to kill your Magras and discard your Cetatine Jade Tree.
All right.
And then I'll end the turn and then I'll just finish you on my next turn.
Alright, we'll play Illusionary Merfolk. He's gonna do something, I swear.
Oh yeah,
go ahead.
For sure. Alright, I'll draw. Alright, we'll just do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We are going to evolve Blazosaur into Cutronic Gargantua. And then I'm just gonna Tornado Flame the Merfolk. We have this guy, he is gonna be breaking... Let's see, he's a crew breaker, so I break one shield for each of my survivors. So I go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm a Septa breaker, and I'll just break everything.
Yep, you got it.
And then we'll go in. Boom!
Kind of thinking I should have added Aqua Surfer to this list, actually, to be quite honest.
I think a lot of decks in this era should have added Aqua Surfer,
yeah,
to be fair.
It feels like... not as popular it should have been. Anyways, GG. On to game 2.
Yep.
Do I want to go first or second against this deck? I'm actually not sure.
I'm playing the deck and I don't know if I should have gone first or not.
I think I'll go first.
Okay.
Alright, we'll send Cenotine Jade Tree to mana and end.
I'll draw. I'll put Spike Strike Ichthys to mana and end. There is actually blockers in your deck, so he could be relevant.
We will send... Weird one. Yeah, okay. You will play Emerald, and we're not going to use the effect.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Go ahead.
That must be some damn good cards in your hand, huh?
I mean, not really, if I'm being honest.
Because I feel like if I have bad cards, I always want to just, like, put them down and get something else. But, I mean, maybe, like, you just don't want to put something down knowing that it's not a trigger, I guess. Let's just charge the Ripple Lotus and end.
We'll send Crazed Valkyrie to mana. We will play Aqua Hulkus.
Yep.
Now, do we want to go in? Going in and running into a burst shot feels like pretty bad.
Yeah, that would be probably worse than me running into Terror Pit in the previous episode.
Happens if we don't. Yeah, I don't think we can risk it. Go ahead.
I will draw. Skull Sweeper's mana. Go ahead. This is a problem of playing a four-color deck, is that you can get a lot of times where you have cards that you can't play, and
yeah,
the hands brick a little bit.
All right, send Sarius to mana and end.
Okay, I'm gonna run out a Skull Sweeper Q. Go ahead.
Send Energy Stream. And we'll tap 5 for the Illusionary Merfolk.
Oh, okay, that makes sense why you would put the Energy Stream down at that point.
Yeah.
Alright, I dig it.
Yeah, this was a weird one because I had like a really aggressive start, and you obviously had a slow start, but like I really needed to hit this turn 5 Merfolk, I feel like.
I think if you went in, I almost for sure could have killed the Emerald in some way or another.
Yeah, that was sort of what I was worried about. Anyways, now that that isn't an issue, we could go in. I don't know how much reason there is to go in either. Yeah, go ahead. Force you to Searing Wave or something. I guess Searing Wave only hits 2 of my guys anyways.
Man, like, what can you do to me with 6 mana? You can do a lot to me with 6 mana.
6 mana and 5 cards in hand.
I think I just run out the Blazosaur and end the turn, which doesn't feel great. I might regret that.
Right, no way not playing mana is right. I refuse to believe that.
No, it cannot be. Not when you have 6 cards in your hand. There's got to be something you don't need.
Okay, we'll send Aqua Hulkus to mana.
Okay, yeah, reasonable. You don't really need to be drawing cards right now.
I like drawing cards.
No,
though.
Are you going to play another Aqua Hulkus?
No, we're going to play Year of Lightning. Tap down the Skull Sweeper. And
I kind of figured something like that, or maybe a Holy Owl was coming.
Sarius.
Yep.
First things, let me think. I guess no matter what, Illusionary Merfolk is attacking, and one of our creatures is killing the Skull Sweeper.
Yeah, yeah.
Do
absolutely.
I want to go in with these other two? So we're in a like a weird spot here where like I think I want to put the pressure on. So like the only way you come back into this game, I feel like, is a Searing Wave, and I think. Like, if I go in and you Searing Wave, then you're in pretty spooky territory as far as Crazed Valkyrie goes. So I
that
think
is
I
a true statement.
I think I just want to go in and, like, apply as much pressure as possible. Like,
yeah.
And, like, all you can really do is use Searing Wave if that's what you're doing.
Yep.
And then, alright, those are both good. Go ahead, then.
Well, I can tell you I certainly was holding the Searing Wave, so we're actually gonna have to do that no matter what.
Okay.
So let's get rid of this shield. Oh, I got rid of a shield trigger. That's a little disappointing. I would have really liked to have that for your merfolk.
Well, we'll tell you there was another thing I was planning when doing that. Because sometimes you're just holding Emerald.
Yeah. Oh,
and
gosh, that
you're
hurts.
Holding Illusionary Merfolk.
Yeah, that is a lot. I kind of thought that was maybe what you were doing.
I didn't use Emerald's effect, and we're going to draw 3 with Merfolk.
Yep.
And at this point, I kind of think we just keep pressure on.
Yeah, when you have that much.
Merfolk's going in.
Yep.
And go ahead.
I think at this point, I just need to hope I have good shield triggers, because there's not much I can do about this. That's the thing about this deck, I can't always answer quickly. If I had a couple turns, I could
right,
answer everything.
Yeah, that's...
But like, it doesn't, the answers don't come out fast enough sometimes. I mean, the best thing I can do, I can drop a powerful creature right here. At 9k
is
a lot of
power.
A powerful
creature.
But it's still banking on having a good shield trigger and like you not putting on too much more pressure out of that 5 cards you're about to have to top
right,
off your
right.
7 mana.
Oh, that's not bad. I guess first we will tap 3 for Energy Stream.
Yep.
Okay, was better than I was anticipating even. We'll play Emeril.
They keep coming.
Set something as shield 6, pick up another thing. Then for 2, we will Spiral Gate the Cutronic Gargantua.
Yep.
Keep you on as little as possible. I guess we swing with Emeril so that Burst Shot doesn't save you.
And it does not save me either way.
Yep.
Alright, GG, game 3.
Alright. This is a neat matchup, actually.
Yeah, this is a cool match. I like this game. This is a lot more interesting than the past few games. I've just been like, rush. But I still have, like, I still don't know who wants to go first. That's the problem.
I'm not 100% sure either.
Honestly, I think I would rather you go first, but I haven't decided that for sure yet. This is still me thinking to myself. Because my problem with that game was, like, I had good stuff, but I just didn't happen to draw the low-cost stuff. And, well, the low-cost stuff that I did have, I didn't have the right colors for it, which makes me feel like I want to go second to help guarantee I get the other colors.
Okay, so you're actually going second, is that...?
I'm thinking.
Alright.
But if I go first, it helps me swarm a little bit earlier. And you do not have discard. But it makes it so you have a higher chance of drawing your merfolks and stuff. You know what? I'm gonna go first this time, actually.
Alright.
Ooh, interesting. Very interesting. Wow, okay. It's so funny, this hand looks nothing like my other hand. It's like I'm playing a different deck. What is happening? Okay, we're gonna charge the Grave Worm. Go ahead.
As we send Spiral Gate to mana and end.
Yeah, I don't think you have any one drops. Alright, let's draw. I'll put the Smash Horn to mana, and I'm gonna Fairy Life, and I'll end.
Alright.
This definitely helps in the get my survivors early, or get the mana early to play the survivors early.
Alright, we'll send Magris to mana, and we will play Emeril.
Emeril, okay.
Set a card as shield 6, pick up another one, and go ahead.
I'll draw. It's such a weird one. Do I want to do it like that? This feels... maybe? Yeah, I'm going to play the Bronze Arm to mana, and I'll run out a Smash Horn Q. I don't feel like I need the Bronze Arm effect.
You're only playing 2 colors this game, apparently.
Yeah, that's why I was like, this looks nothing like my other hand. This doesn't happen in a 4-color deck very often. But I almost wanted to just Bronze Arm just to get the other colors down there, so I have them.
We'll play Corile to mana and end.
Alright. Unlock Fire Mana.
That is fair.
Okay, I'm gonna run out Skull Sweeper.
Alright.
And I think I don't have a reason not to make you discard. I mean, it's, you do choose, but I'd rather get you to discard something. If you didn't play anything...
We'll discard Emeril.
Okay.
This, yep, that's good.
Alright, go ahead.
We'll play Sarius to mana, and then we will play Magris.
Yep.
Draw a card, and you can go ahead.
I kind of don't feel like this is the right play, but maybe it is. No, wait, that cannot be the right play. Never mind.
I feel like so often, in like these sort of mid-rangey decks, you have to make really weird plays on like your turn 5 and 6 sometimes.
I was just a couple cards off of this being a little bit better. I'm gonna charge Spike Strike Ichthys just to unlock my fourth sieve. Now I have to think. I'm crying over here. If this Spike Strike Ichthys could have just been a factory shell, my play could have been very obvious, but it's not.
And definitely, when you're not just playing Factory Shell, that's usually a good thing for me. I'm just wondering what you could be holding.
It's a weird one, for sure.
Maybe you're holding... Maybe you're holding Terrapin. You are thinking about Terrapinning my Emeril or something.
I will say, the card in my hand... Or maybe I shouldn't say that. That might give something away. I'm not gonna say that.
Right.
It doesn't give away much, but I mean, you can't be too certain. I'll leave you in the dark a little bit. unless I decide to play it. This is just the dumbest setup. No, there's no way it's the right play. I'm ending my turn.
Right, alright.
Just play your merfolk.
Well, we don't have merfolk.
Okay.
Turns out.
Well, that's like, at least I got that going for me. Corile probably doesn't feel too great either, to be honest. There's a lot of cards you could play that just don't feel great.
Yeah, don't think I'm gonna be playing any of those, as it turns out.
Really? Okay. Out of 5 cards. Interesting.
Okay, we'll send Spiral Gate to mana.
Mm-hmm.
We'll play Energy Stream.
Oh, okay. That's probably gonna get you closer to something, one of those that I mentioned.
And that's it. Go ahead.
I will draw.
We've got the value game. I'll pretend like a control deck for right now.
I'm gonna play the Spike Strike like this.
Alright.
My guys are unblockable, which is actually not that bad, but I'll just end the turn there.
Right. Draw.
I get the feeling Craze Valkyrie is probably dropping. Or, I mean, Merfolk. There's a lot of things that could be dropping on me right now. You've got so much in your hand.
That is true. Oh, this is a bit of an awkward play, unfortunately. But we'll send Aqua Hulkus to mana.
Mm-hmm.
We will play Craze Valkyrie, and yep. I would really like to kill your Spike Strike and your Skull Sweeper, but I can't actually do that
because
Smashhorn buffs everything.
Yep.
But we have to tap down the Smashhorn and the Skull Sweeper. Craze Valkyrie is going to hit Smashhorn.
Yep.
Debuff your field, and then Emerald will suicide into the Skull Sweeper.
Yep.
And go ahead.
I'll draw. That's not what I wanted to see. I'm gonna play Burst Shot to mana and just end my turn.
Oh, jeez. Okay.
I draw the Burst Shot right when your Emerald dies.
Yep.
I guess, I would have played it to try to make you not Merfolk, but I guess you're not now anyways, unless you just drop another one.
Well, we'll send Sarius to mana. We will tap four for Magris.
Mm-hmm. Oh, you're getting a lot of cards.
Three for Miel, Vizier of Lightning.
Yeah.
Praise Valkyrie will kill that one.
This is not looking great.
And these ones can attack. Go ahead.
Alright, I'm gonna play Ripple Lotus Q and end my turn. I need a Factory Shell! Factory Shell could be a game changer.
Oh, and this isn't the best Holy Awe in the world, but I mean, I guess we'll do it.
I mean, it's not horrible.
Magris will kill that.
Yep.
I mean, I don't think your deck really has much in the way of defense, as it turns out. I mean, I could run into a Terror Pit, which would hurt, but I don't think we play scared around Terror Pit for too long.
Yeah, and no Terror Pit.
Then Miel will hit Shield 3, so we are threatening to win game next turn.
Yeah.
And go ahead.
Alright, there is a lot of cards in my hand that I really wish I had just a little bit earlier. Which is kind of unfortunate.
Yeah, this is the problem with the Survivor decks, because, when they go off, they absolutely go off.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we saw it in the first game.
You need all the pieces to come together, and you don't always have ways to find them. And, especially, when some decks are running Locomotivers and stuff.
Yeah.
It can get a bit dicey.
I think my best option here is, unfortunately, the Searing Wave.
Yep.
Because that will pretty much guarantee I survive a turn, at least. I mean, you can definitely Evo. And then just run out of Smashhorn Q. The Searing Wave would have been a lot nicer to have before the Evo dropped. I just realized, I think the Searing Wave killed the card underneath Craze Valkyrie.
It did, yeah. You're not wrong. Right. I think it was a Magris, right? I guess this could matter if you have,
I don't think it matters.
If you have Bounce, which I don't know if you do, but just in case, I'll bring that.
Of course.
Okay.
Thank you.
It's a Magris. If it matters, yeah. I'll bring it back from the graveyard.
Good old OCTGN.
Okay, here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna play Sarius Vizier of Suppression, and we are going to play Illusionary Merfolk, which we don't have a Cyberlord. This is not the best Illusionary Merfolk in the world.
Hey, it's a 4K but beater on board.
I think I'm fine with just things that can attack now. Praise Valkyrie's gonna hit your last shield.
Yep.
I think as long as that wasn't a trigger, I don't know what you can do to win.
I don't think I can do anything.
Tornado Flame trigger and Terror Pit from hand, I think that would have saved you.
I mean, all I can really do is Factory Shell, search out Blazosaur, search out whatever, it doesn't matter because I'm going to die. But okay, you got it.
I was holding on to two more Holy Oz.
Oh my god.
Which is why I wasn't so worried about using the last, although I only had one of these at the time.
Yeah.
But
that is a lot of tap. That, like, this deck is good at tapping me down before I can get going. I was able to luckily do it in the first game. All right, well, let's set these up and take a look at these decks side by side.
This deck just felt so good to look at it in the deck editor.
Yeah.
40 cards, almost everything is a 4 of.
Oh, those just feel so clean. This deck is satisfying just because I love Survivors.
Survivors? I think I would have played Survivors if I spun it.
Oh yeah, I was not
upset
about
spinning this. This
was
actually my first spin, though.
Honestly, this wheel was so much better than some of the past weeks, where, like, I wasn't really worried about spinning anything,
yeah.
And I felt like no matter what I spun, I probably would have just been okay with it.
I wasn't, so, like, when I was recording the wheel spin, I, like, wasn't really thinking. I was like, all right, which of these decks do I want to play? And I was kind of getting ready to say, like, oh, yeah. Then, like, I actually looked at the wheel, and I was kind of like, I'd be fine with almost any of these decks.
Yep. Well, I'm glad I was able to get my deck running in the first game. I think going first maybe was a mistake because I kind of ran myself out of steam with my own fairy life.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Like, the reason I wanted to go first in game two, I wanted to, like, ensure that I could get Merfolk down before your removal could get rid of my Emerald.
Yeah, that does
that
make a lot of
sense. Because, like, that matters if I draw Emerald and Illusionary Merfolk and you draw the removal. So, like,
right.
I don't know. I don't know what the right play was. Move this over.
Yep. There we go. Bam. Yeah. So this deck, was that like a tournament winning deck that you had, or where'd you find that list from? What was the pull from?
It was one of the ones you had found. Let me look at it again to see what it was. And this was Texas Invitation Circuit second place.
All right.
You did put the disclaimer actually from set 7 as far as when the tournament happened, but uses no set 7 cards.
You missed out on the Thrash Crawler.
I did do that.
Oh man, all right, but I mean, honestly, you proved
bringing
it
back
really
down
needed.
To 40 cards.
Yeah, because, like, realistically, do you need to take anything from your mana zone when nothing is like one of, everything is like 4 of? Anything that's not a 4 of, are you going to be taking back from your mana zone? Probably not.
Yeah, I mean, like, you don't always want to be, like, playing a ton of mana unless you, like, get the Merfolks going or something.
Yep.
No,
yep.
It sort of makes sense, but I was just like, I'll just take this out, this one of Thrash Crawler, and run with the 40 card list.
Yep. My deck was from a tournament where this Survivor deck won an Invitation Circuit tournament, but this isn't the official list. This is the list recreated from someone else's memory because the real list didn't exist. But it was like, as you can see, it's pretty straightforward. So, like, maybe the counts were a little bit different here and there, but it's pretty accurate to, like, what it actually looked like. And realistically, I can see how this would win a tournament because back then, people weren't really considering Survivors as, like, one of the top decks. So it kind of caught people off guard.
Yeah, so like, because, like, in set 5, Survivors was really bad, and, like, people tried them out and said, this deck sucks, I'm never playing it again, which was pretty much right. But, like, getting Factory Shell and Cutronic Gargantua, and didn't even really think about Ripple Lotus Cube, but that probably matters a lot too, actually.
Ripple Lotus and Grave Worm.
Like, with this new support, like, it actually becomes a real deck. And, like, with Factory Shell, you just up off so quickly they can't deal with it.
Yeah, like, once I got the Factory Shell stuck on the board, it's like you win. I just wasn't able to draw it in the last games there,
right.
Like, get it in time. So I think, like, in this matchup in particular, it's probably pretty good for Water Light because, like, there's just so much tap stuff that kind of prevents me from getting my field going to begin with. But if you think about, like, what a lot of the decks looked like at the time, there was a lot of, like, Water Darkness control, where, like, the best option they had would have been, like, the Death Smokes and Terror Pits. But not, like, you'd have your 4 Terror Pits and maybe, like, 2 Death Smoke or something. So, like, you have to have it, and if you don't have it, then...
And you've also got the Grave Worm to just get it back, right?
Yes, yeah, exactly. But if you just keep tapping my stuff down, it's hard to stick anything on the field for long enough to make it relevant. And Crazed Valkyrie being a double breaker, it helps a lot too, because as you can see, there's not much in the way of defense in this deck. There's no blockers. There's just like some shield triggers, which I unfortunately didn't get any, which was not great, but I mean, you can't expect to get them all the time. So it makes it like in those situations where like, if you can tap one of my guys and then just start putting pressure on a few shields, I think that's the way to like beat this kind of survivor deck. Keep right, stuff off right. the board and then get the pressure on and just don't give them the chance to build up that field. Meanwhile, like looking at the your deck, the way I win is by searing waving your initiates.
Yeah, I think you really have to get an early board wipe in this matchup, quite honestly.
Yeah.
If you can't kill my cheap things, like I'm probably gonna have either Merfolk or Crazed Valkyrie.
So that one then... turn when I was thinking for a long time, I had my field was something like Smash Horn and Skull Sweeper, and you had like you had an Emerald and maybe like a chump blocker or something, I can't remember. Like some initiate anyways. And I was holding a burst shot. Okay. And I thought about burst shotting just to kill the Emerald at the cost of my Skull Sweeper.
Yeah.
Because
I
didn't
see.
Want you merfolking, but it didn't feel worth it.
Yeah.
Because I needed think, board presence.
I think I didn't even have merfolk in hand that
I Yeah, you anyways. Didn't get it on your turn, otherwise you would have played it for sure. One thing I do find funny about this deck is the 4 Spike Strike Ichthys Q, which is honestly probably like the worst card in this deck, but it's just a generic survivor, and it's
just
like
water mana.
Yeah, it's water mana that's also a survivor, essentially. Right. The other option is there's like that turtle thing, Split Head Turtle something Q, I think.
Yeah, that card's decent.
But
actually,
this, like,
to be quite honest, I would probably go like 2-2 or something if I were making this.
Yeah. Oh, I was gonna say, I think the reason that they picked it Spike Strike Ichthys Q over the turtle was because there were still Diamond Cutter decks running around.
That's
and like
true.
If they're building up a big field of blockers, it could be hard to deal with. But if you get all your survivors and then you just drop this thing and now you have a whole board of unblockables, like you just get under any kind of blocker deck.
Yeah, so I mean, my thought is that Splithead Hydro Turtle is, like, generically better, but there's some situations where you really want Spike Strike Ichthys.
Yeah.
But you have Factory Shell, so, like,
right,
you can
right.
just search
so you...
it up whenever you want.
Because ideally,
like, I would
if you're
run,
winning,
like,
you're
one
searching.
Or two of those.
Yeah.
Then, yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think if I were to rebuild it, that would make sense to do, like, a 2-2 split. Because it would be enough in that when you get the Factory Shell and the Grave Worms, you can just find it when you need it.
Yeah, like, in purest deck builder in me wants to only run one Spike Strike Ichthys Q, and then it's just, like, grab it. But that's a bit harder in DM, because, like, if it's in your shields, then you're just screwed.
Yep, exactly. So after Stomp-A-Trons, we run into another classic situation where the next set kind of blows, right? It's not as bad as Rampage, because we do get, like, Apocalypse Vise, we get Cryptic Totem, and we get Hopeless Vortex. But realistically, that's about it that's going to be coming next week in Thundercharge of Ultra Destruction. So I think the wheel looks kind of similar, but there's just a few changes that are more of just, like, shifts in how people were building decks, rather than what kind of decks were actually viable. Though, to be fair, I do think the introduction of Apocalypse Vise does make people lean a little bit heavier into fire and for their control decks, which
honestly,
really bumps up
think,
the popularity of Darkwater Fire.
Cryptic Totem was a huge incentive to run nature and control decks also, I think.
Yeah, oh, definitely. That's another fun card. That's like another one of those decks that back in the day, I never played it at a tournament, but I would not be upset spinning it on the wheel and getting a chance to use it. So yeah, we're gonna wrap this one up here. We finally had a game 3. That's exciting.
At the the first episode had a game 3.
Yeah, we're finally not rolling like good deck against bad deck. Like I would say these are probably pretty close to each other in the meta in terms of like viability.
Yeah.
They're not like the top meta decks, but they're there and they can win.
Right.
All right. Well, we're just gonna wrap it up there, guys. We'll catch you guys next week for Thundercharge of Ultra Destruction. Peace!